Chapter 9. Samuel Mudd, Booth, and the Other Conspirators. Besides Mary Surratt, seven others were put on trial in 1865 for their part in the plot to murder Abraham Lincoln and other high government officials. There are two questions to consider. Were they really responsible for these crimes, and how many of them were Catholics? Dr. Samuel Mudd was found guilty of conspiring to murder the president and other leaders, according to the specification, in particular, acting to advise, encourage, receive, entertain, harbor, and conceal, aid and assist the said John Wilkes Booth. In his book, His Name is Still Mudd, Edward Steers Jr. showed that Samuel Mudd was not an innocent doctor who just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time, who unknowingly helped the wrong person, but someone deeply involved in the plan to kidnap President Lincoln, and one who, while knowing who he was and what he had just done, helped Booth in his flight to escape U.S. authorities. There is no question that Dr. Mudd was a Catholic. The evidence arrayed against the Maryland doctor was quite similar to that brought against Mary Surratt. Both of them had someone who had played a major part in the conspiracy visit their home after Lincoln's assassination. Louis Paine came to Mrs. Surratt's house, and John Wilkes Booth came to Dr. Mudd's. As opposed to those who knew too much, Mary Surratt and Samuel Mudd, however, knew too little. They both tried to maintain that they hadn't recognized people that they had met and talked to weeks or months earlier. Court testimony showed that Mudd definitely knew Booth. U.S. Army officer Colonel H.H. Wells stated that Mudd told him that he had been introduced to Booth in November 1864 at the Catholic church the doctor attended in southern Maryland. Booth had inquired if there were any good, reasonably priced horses in the neighborhood, and Dr. Mudd said there was. Booth stayed at the doctor's house that night, and he bought a horse from one of Mudd's neighbors the next day. Defense witness John C. Thompson confirmed this, testifying that he, Booth, and another man attended a service in the Catholic Church at Bryantown on a Sunday around the latter part of October last, or perhaps in November. Meeting Mudd outside the church, Thompson introduced him to Booth. Another witness, Thomas Gardner, stated that his uncle sold a horse to Booth in November 1864. Testifying in Dr. Samuel Mudd's defense, Dr. George Mudd, a relative who lived near him, stated that the news of Lincoln's murder by Booth reached their area on the afternoon of Saturday, April 15th. He also testified that on the next day, he met Samuel Mudd in church. On their journey home, Samuel Mudd told him that two suspicious men had come to his home on Saturday morning, and one of them had had a broken leg. The two Mudds agreed that George Mudd would inform the authorities, which George Mudd said he did Monday morning. Military personnel pursuing Booth and Harold reported that when they questioned Samuel Mudd, he was nervous, evasive, and untruthful. Detective Simon Gavican testified that when he was at Mudd's home on Tuesday, April 18th, "We inquired if two men passed there on the Saturday morning after the assassination, and Dr. Mudd said no. Then we inquired more particularly if two men had been there, one having his leg fractured. He said yes." Joshua Lloyd, another detective, said essentially the same thing. He reported that Mudd initially denied that he had seen Booth, Harold, or Surratt. Later, though, Mudd admitted that two men came to his home at 4 o'clock Saturday morning, but offered no explanation for his previous denial. Other military personnel who interviewed Mudd also reported his evasiveness. Mudd's defense maintained that he had only met Booth in November of the previous year. At that time, he had seen him for just two concurrent days and then hadn't seen him again until the assassin came to his home the morning after the president's murder. According to Colonel Wells, Mudd said he didn't recognize the actor because he was disguised. Dr. Mudd's wife, Sarah, evidently also said Booth was disguised. Mudd's defense for his actions, then, was that he didn't know it was Booth because he had changed his appearance. No proof was ever provided by any other witnesses that Booth had changed his appearance before he arrived at Mudd's house, or after he left, however. The only evidence that Booth was disguised and conveniently unrecognizable, therefore, came just from the accused himself and his wife. John Lloyd, who gave provisions to Booth and Harold on their way, said nothing about this. Lloyd also testified that Harold told him that he was pretty sure they had assassinated the president and Secretary Seward. If they told Lloyd this, wouldn't they have told Mudd as well? Lieutenant Alexander Lovett testified that when he was at Mudd's home on April 18th, the doctor did not at first seem inclined to give us any satisfaction. Afterwards, he went on to state that on Saturday morning, at daybreak, two strangers had come to his place. Mudd said that one of the men had a broken leg, but he did not know who the man was. Lovett reported that the colored people present told him that they recognized Booth as being the man with the broken leg who was there on Saturday, though the news that he was responsible for President Lincoln's murder hadn't yet reached them. Captain George Dutton declared that on his way to prison after sentencing, Dr. Mudd confessed that he did recognize Booth when the murderer came to his home. Mudd also confirmed that he was in the company of Booth when they met John Surratt and Louis Weichman on 7th Street in Washington, as Weichman had stated. Booth had wanted to meet John Surratt, so they met and had a private conversation that evening. Mudd heard about Dutton's statement and he denied admitting that he had known it was Booth who had come to his home. Mudd did admit to meeting John Surratt and Louis Weichman on a Washington street in the company of Booth and then going into Booth's hotel room for drinks, however. This meeting had been steadfastly denied by the conspirators' lawyers. Mudd's lawyer, Thomas Ewing, maintained that before the assassin arrived at the doctor's home with a broken leg, Mudd had met Booth only once, and Colonel H.H. Wells reported that Mudd had told him that he had been introduced to Booth at church in November and hadn't seen him again until the morning after Lincoln's assassination. Edward Steers, however, asserted that there was evidence that showed that Samuel Mudd had actually met Booth three times before April 15th, twice in the neighborhood of Mudd's home and then in Washington. He alleged the reason Mudd did not want the government to know about a second meeting with Booth near Mudd's home in Bryantown was because it was set up by him for the purpose of introducing Booth to Thomas Harbin, a Confederate Secret Service agent. Steer stated, "Mudd appears to be a principal recruiter for Booth, at least in regard to two very important members of his team, Thomas Harbin and John Surratt." Of all the conspirators enlisted into Booth's gang, Harbin and Surratt were the most competent and experienced, and the two who were already active agents of the Confederate underground. Steers asserted that Mudd had met with Booth at least three times in the 6 months before Lincoln's assassination. According to Colonel Wells and Thomas Gardner, Mudd saw the actor on three consecutive days in November 1864 on the first occasion, and Booth stayed at the doctor's home at least one night. When Booth came to Dr. Mudd's home on the morning of April 15th, it is extremely hard to believe that there was no spark of recognition when he talked to and treated this well-known public person. In all likelihood, Mudd instantly recognized Booth if he had not already been expecting him according to a prearranged plan. Edward Steers pointed out that although Samuel Mudd knew it was Booth that he had treated and knew or soon would know what he had done, he did not inform the authorities via Dr. George Mudd until April 17th. Even then, he didn't identify the man he treated as Booth, and he evidently directed the soldiers pursuing the fugitives to go the opposite way that Booth and Harold had gone. His actions caused more than a 40-hour delay in the chase for the pair, providing them with crucial time to try to make good their escape. Steers also disclosed the role that one particular Catholic church evidently played in treasonous activities. Booth's presence at St. Mary's Church in November and again in December is testified to by John F. Hardy, who places him there on both occasions. St. Mary's was the church of Dr. William Queen, the senior Confederate sympathizer in Charles County, and the man who brought Booth to that church on the two occasions that Dr. Mudd was known to have been there. That Mudd attended St. Mary's Church when Booth was there furthering his plans suggests that it was a rendezvous for important members of the Confederate underground. Court testimony showed that Samuel Mudd's sympathies lay with the Confederacy. One witness, Milo Sims, testified that he heard Mudd agree with an acquaintance, Benjamin Gardner, when he said Lincoln ought to have been dead a long time ago. Another witness heard Dr. Mudd make no objection when Gardner told the doctor that General Stonewall Jackson would soon capture Washington and burn Lincoln in his house. Dr. Mudd was in favor of slavery and had been the owner of a number of slaves. Not surprisingly, he opposed emancipation. Although all slaves were destined for freedom by the end of the Civil War, he remained prejudiced against blacks. While several colored people who had worked for him said he treated his servants well, some of the slaves that Mudd owned reportedly had been treated harshly, and the doctor had actually shot one of them, L.Z. Eglint, who had been disobedient. Eglint survived the shooting. Several months after arriving in prison in Fort Jefferson, Florida, Mudd's prejudice caused him to try to escape. In letters to relatives, he stated that he had tried to get away because he hated being guarded by colored soldiers. In the early part of the 20th century, relatives of Samuel Mudd began what has been a long and unsuccessful campaign to clear his name, and his case still appears in the news. In 1992, a moot court at the University of Richmond School of Law ruled on the question of whether the military commission that judged Dr. Mudd had the legal jurisdiction to try him. Arguing on Mudd's side was the great-great-granddaughter of Brigadier General Thomas Ewing, Jr., Mudd's lawyer in 1865. Also on Mudd's side was high-profile criminal lawyer F. Lee Bailey, who gained fame through his part in the 1995 defense of the murderer of Nicole Brown Simpson and Ron Goldman. In November 2002, the U.S. Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia blocked Richard Mudd's attempt to overturn his grandfather's conviction when it dismissed his 1992 complaint against the U.S. Army. The family has vowed to fight on. In the end, however, despite the efforts of his descendants to portray Mudd as a kindly country doctor who had been convicted of merely helping an injured stranger, the evidence shows that the government was correct and this Catholic man was guilty of assisting in the conspiracy to murder Abraham Lincoln and was fortunate to escape the death penalty. John Wilkes Booth. While John Wilkes Booth was not put on trial, he clearly was one of the leaders of the conspiracy, if not the main leader. He certainly was the man who assassinated President Lincoln. The question is, to what church did he belong? In 50 years, Charles Chinique alleged that the actor was a Protestant pervert to Romanism. In her 1982 article in the Lincoln Herald, Insights on John Wilkes Booth from his sister Asia's correspondence, historian Constance Head stated that strong evidence pointed to the fact that Booth indeed was a Catholic. Booth's sister, Asia Booth Clark, wrote a memoir of her brother which was published after her death. College history professor Terry Alford, a leading authority on the life of John Wilkes Booth, attested to how valuable a witness Booth Clark is regarding her brother's life. He stated, Asia Booth Clark's memoir of her brother John Wilkes Booth has been recognized as the single most important document available for understanding the personality of the assassin of President Abraham Lincoln, adding that no outsider could give such insights into the turbulent Booth's childhood or share such unique personal knowledge of the gifted actor. Alford edited a recent edition of the memoir. Ms. Head agreed, declaring that Asia should be accurate in the matter of her brother's religious preference. Head quoted from a letter the actor's sister had written to a friend regarding the assassination and the conspirators. Booth Clark wrote, I was shocked and grieved to see the names of Michael O'Loughlin and Samuel Arnold among the conspirators. I am still more surprised to learn that all engaged in the plot are Roman Catholics. Wilkes was of the faith professedly, and I was glad that he had fixed his faith on one religion. Head also stated, although the Booth family was traditionally Episcopalian, Asia personally was very much inclined toward Catholicism as the result of her schooling at the Carmelite Convent in Baltimore. Eventually, she became a Catholic herself, and although the date of her conversion is unknown, it is a matter which she and Wilkes may have discussed. It is even conceivable that it was Asia who converted him. On the other hand, perhaps as an actor, he was simply attracted by the dramatic beauty of the Mass. He seemed, moreover, to have entertained a low opinion of certain Protestant clergymen who preached the sinfulness of the stage, and thus may have been drawn toward Catholicism as a faith more congenial to his vocation. In any case, it seems certain that Booth did not publicize his conversion during his lifetime, and while there is no reasonable cause to connect Booth's religious preference and his mad act, the few who knew of his conversion must have decided after the assassination that for the good of the church, it was best never to mention it. Thus, the secret remained so well guarded that even the most rabidly anti-Catholic writers who tried to depict the assassination of Lincoln as a Jesuit or Papist plot were puzzled by the seemingly accurate information that John Wilkes Booth was an Episcopalian. If any other proof is needed to show the actor was a Roman Catholic after the compelling evidence provided by his sister, several other facts point to Booth's Catholicism. Like his sister, he received education at a school established by an official of the Catholic Church. When he was a boarding student at St. Charles College in Pikesville, Maryland, Lewis Weichmann and Samuel Arnold also attended this school. The Catholic parish history that revealed this information took pains to point out that this institution was a non-denominational school or academy established by a priest named Father Waldron, not to be confused with St. Charles College, a seminary for training priests at a different location, 5 miles west of Ellicott City, Maryland. Weichmann and John Surratt had attended the latter school. Evidence given at the trial of John Surratt showed that at his death, Booth had a small Catholic medal on his person. As well, on at least two occasions, court testimony showed him attending Roman Catholic church services. There reportedly is also evidence that he made a donation to St. Aloysius Catholic Church in Washington. It would be quite unusual for someone who received education from a priest to be carrying a Catholic medal on his person and attending Catholic church services and even donating to the church, yet not be a Catholic. All of this, however, would naturally follow if, as his sister was undoubtedly correct in asserting, the assassin of Abraham Lincoln, John Wilkes Booth, was a Roman Catholic. Michael O'Loughlin. Michael O'Loughlin was tried for his part in Lincoln's murder and given a life sentence by the military commission. A veteran of the Confederate Armed Forces during the early part of the Civil War, the evidence shows that in addition to being part of the conspiracy, he too was a Catholic. He died in an outbreak of yellow fever at the prison of Fort Jefferson in the Dry Tortugas, Florida, on September 23, 1867. O'Loughlin was a boyhood friend of John Wilkes Booth and Samuel Arnold, living in the same neighborhood in Baltimore. Beginning in February 1865, he and Arnold were roommates in a Washington rooming house. Their landlady testified that Booth visited them frequently there. Arnold and O'Loughlin told her that they were engaged in the oil business, a term Booth and other conspirators used as a cover for their secret plans. O'Loughlin received a telegraph message from Booth on March 13, 1865, and another 2 weeks later on March 27. Given in evidence before the commission, the March 13th communication read, "Don't fear to neglect your business. You had better come at once. Signed, J. Booth." The latter one read, "Get word to Sam, come on, with or without him. Wednesday morning, we sell that day sure, don't fail, J. Wilkes Booth." Undoubtedly the Sam referred to was Samuel Arnold. This message, which spoke about selling, evidently referred to the same non-existent business that a suspicious letter of Booth's found in the National Hotel spoke about. Discovered in an envelope bearing the initials JWB, the letter was also given in evidence before the military commission. The hotel clerk who found it testified that the only guest that he knew of that had those initials was John Wilkes Booth. Dated April 6, 1865, it used the same term, "don't fail." Michael O'Loughlin and three other associates, James Henderson, Bernard Early, and Edward Murphy, came by train to Washington from Baltimore on the evening of April 13th. They had allegedly come to see the fireworks scheduled for that evening and to generally enjoy themselves. O'Loughlin went to see Booth that night in the actor's room in the National Hotel. O'Loughlin was also identified as the man who twice appeared at the home of Secretary of War Stanton later that night, first asking to see General Grant, who was visiting, and then Stanton. His requests were denied. On the day of the assassination, Michael O'Loughlin left his friends in the morning to visit Booth again in his hotel room. As noted earlier, Charles Wood testified that O'Loughlin came into his barber shop that morning in the company of Booth, John Surratt, and another man. Other than this two-hour period in the morning, O'Loughlin's whereabouts on the day of the 14th were essentially accounted for by his associates. The next afternoon, on April 15th, O'Loughlin and company returned to Baltimore. O'Loughlin was arrested there on April 17th by an officer named William Wallace. Wallace stated that when O'Loughlin was arrested, he seemed to understand what it was for and did not ask any questions about it. At the time, O'Loughlin said he knew nothing of the assassination whatsoever and could account for his whereabouts during all the time of his stay in Washington by the parties who were with him. There was a two-hour period in the morning of the 14th, however, when no person except the prosecution witness, Charles Wood, could account for his whereabouts. No one, therefore, could directly contradict Wood's testimony that O'Loughlin, Booth, and John Surratt were in his shop that morning. The defense called seven witnesses who testified that they were with or saw O'Loughlin at a time and location in Washington that the defense obviously thought would prove that he could not have been at the Secretary of War's house on the evening of the 13th. Three prosecution witnesses asserted he had been at Stanton's home that night. These defense witnesses were not independent, however. In fact, they were his friends and associates. At the trial of John Surratt, prosecution witness William Cleaver stated that because he was well acquainted with Surratt, he was inclined to shield him. He had not told the military commission that he had seen Surratt in Washington on April 14th. Could O'Loughlin's associates have also acted to shield their friend by stating that he was with them every moment that evening when he really wasn't? O'Loughlin's lawyer, Walter Cox, declared that his client, along with two of his associates, had been invited by Henderson to go from Baltimore to Washington on Thursday, the 13th of April, the occasion of the Great Illumination. According to their testimony, however, they never actually saw the innocent spectacle that supposedly was the reason for their trip. They stated that during the fireworks, between 9 and 10 p.m., they were inside a Washington music hall listening to a performance instead. O'Loughlin had gone to Washington to see the fireworks, but he did not see them. He also was supposed to be in a music hall that evening, but was he really somewhere else instead? Why would O'Loughlin be at the Stanton home, asking for Stanton or Grant? If he was planning to assassinate one of these men, it would be helpful to meet them, try to learn some of their habits, get to know what they looked like, and gather information that could be of assistance in carrying out their murders. There was evidence that this had happened before. No less a person than the president's son, Thomas Tad Lincoln, testified at the trial of John Surratt that a man looking very much like Surratt had tried on two occasions to get to speak with his father in March 1865. As well, the letter that was found by Mrs. Mary Benson counseled the one that was to kill Lincoln to get introduced, congratulate him, listen to his stories. The charge and specification against the eight conspirators included conspiring to murder President Lincoln, Vice President Andrew Johnson, Secretary of State William Seward, and the commander of the armies of the United States Army, Ulysses S. Grant. Booth, Atzerodt, Payne, and Herold were to kill the President, Vice President, and the Secretary of State. This left Grant to be murdered and evidently Michael O'Loughlin to do it. The General and his wife were scheduled to accompany the President and Mrs. Lincoln to Ford's Theater, but the Grants changed their plans unexpectedly and left Washington earlier on the day of April 14th. O'Loughlin's lawyer and most of the lawyers for the rest of the accused maintained that there indeed was a conspiracy to kidnap Lincoln, but it had been abandoned well before he was killed. They argued that the conspiracy to assassinate was made just days or hours before the deed, as Atzerodt stated in a confession he made after his arrest. In argument before the military commission, O'Loughlin's counsel, Walter Cox, went over the testimony of prosecution witness Samuel Chester. Chester, an actor who knew Booth, told the commission that in late December 1864 or January 1865, Booth tried to enlist him in a conspiracy to capture the president and other heads of government and take them to Richmond. Chester also testified that in February 1865, Booth told him that he was abandoning the plan to capture Lincoln and the others. Therefore, between perhaps February 1865, as Samuel Chester testified, and possibly as late as 8 o'clock on April 14, 1865, as Atzerodt stated, there was no planning, no activity, no conspiracy to kidnap or kill. The evidence presented at the trial of the conspirators and the trial of John Surratt does not bear this out, though. For example, the supplies brought to Surrattsville in early March, the suspicious telegram to O'Loughlin later in the month, the trips of Mary Surratt to deliver messages to Lloyd about guns and supplies show that the plotters were actively involved in their clandestine activities during this time. It is very hard to believe that O'Loughlin was ignorant of the plans that his associates undoubtedly had in place. Like the other conspirators considered earlier, O'Loughlin was undoubtedly guilty of participating in the conspiracy to kidnap, and despite defense protestations to the contrary, there is evidence to show he was guilty of being part of the plot to kill as well. He was found guilty by the military court appointed to hear the case and received a life sentence for his part in the conspiracy. As with the foregoing conspirators, evidence shows that he was a Catholic. In her book, The Death of Lincoln, 1909, author Clara Laughlin declared that O'Loughlin was a Catholic, and she was certainly unconvinced of the Roman Catholic Church's role in President Lincoln's murder. Lewis Weichmann and Lloyd Lewis also stated that O'Loughlin was a member of the Church of Rome. In addition, as noted earlier, Booth's sister Asia had expressed shock that O'Loughlin and Arnold were among the conspirators and stated that she was even more surprised to learn that all of the conspirators were Catholics. The reason she was shocked by the news that these two were among the conspirators was undoubtedly because she knew them well, probably from childhood like her brother John. Knowing them as she did, she would have known whether they were Catholics or not. If either one of them had not belonged to the Church of Rome, she could not have been still more surprised by the statement that all of the conspirators were Catholics, because she would have known this to be false. Her statements, therefore, confirm that O'Loughlin, like Booth, was a Catholic. Sam Arnold. Like O'Loughlin, Samuel Arnold was tried by the military commission and sentenced to life in prison. The evidence showed that Arnold, a former Confederate soldier, was part of the plot to kidnap the president and probably guilty of more. Eaton Horner helped arrest Arnold at the federal installation of Fortress Monroe, Virginia, on April 17, 1865. Horner testified that at the time of his arrest, Arnold gave a statement in which he gave the names of men that he said were connected with a plot to kidnap the president. Arnold said he took the job of clerk at Fortress Monroe on April 1, 1865. He also stated that some 1 to 3 weeks before going there, he attended a meeting in Washington attended by Booth, O'Loughlin, Atzerodt, John Surratt, and others. He admitted that he had been part of a plot to kidnap Lincoln and take him to the South in order to force the American government to exchange prisoners with the Confederacy. He said he withdrew from the conspiracy at the time because others refused to act the week he was in Washington and because the plan was impractical, but apparently not because it was wrong. When asked if he had ever corresponded with Booth, he initially denied it, but when he was told that a letter written by him to Booth had been found in the actor's hotel room, he admitted doing so. The letter told a very different story than the one Arnold gave to the authorities. In the correspondence, there was a future meeting between himself and Booth anticipated, and it appears the group as a whole. The letter showed that Arnold had not separated from the conspiracy, he only wanted the plan delayed because of government suspicions. Was the enterprise that Arnold was talking about to kidnap or murder? Either way, the lies he told showed he was not innocent and deserved the prison sentence he received. His religious affiliation was not as easy to discover as some of the other conspirators, but as was noted earlier, the same statements by Booth's sister Asia, which confirmed that O'Loughlin was a Catholic, also showed that Arnold was one too. Arnold received at least some of his education through Catholic established institutions as well. He attended St. Charles College with Booth and Weichmann and Georgetown College in Washington, D.C., now Georgetown University, a Jesuit-founded educational institution. Edward Spangler. Edward Spangler, an employee of Ford's Theater, was another of the conspirators. After being found guilty by the military commission, he was given a 6-year prison sentence. According to testimony at the trial of the conspirators, on the evening of April 14th, John Wilkes Booth rode up the alley to the back of the theater and called for him to come and hold his horse. Spangler went out to see him and then ordered another employee, Joseph Burroughs, to hold the animal because he was too busy to do it. Burroughs also testified that during the afternoon, when he was helping him to prepare the presidential box, Spangler had cursed President Lincoln and General Grant. Jacob Ritterspah, a carpenter at Ford's Theater, stated that while he was standing behind the scenes during the play on the fateful evening, he heard the sound of a gun and then someone called out that the president had been shot. When he saw a man with a knife in his hand running toward the back door, he ran after him, but the man struck at him with the weapon, forcing Ritterspah back. The knife-wielding man then ran out in the alley to the horse being held by Burroughs, kicked him out of the way, mounted the horse, and rode off. When he went back into the theater to where he had heard the shot, Ritterspah stated that Edward Spangler hit him on the face with the back of his hand, and he said, "Don't say which way he went." I asked him what he meant by slapping me in the mouth, and he said, "For God's sake, shut up," and that was the last he said. Ritterspah testified that when he heard the shot, Spangler was standing near him. When he left his position close to Spangler to chase the man with the knife, the carpenter did not see the assassin's face well enough to recognize who he was chasing. He said he did not hear it was Booth until he had again gone outside the theater, which was after Spangler had struck him. Spangler then must have known who Ritterspah was chasing, and his attempts to hinder the pursuit of the assassin shows his involvement in the plot. John T. Ford, the proprietor of the theater, testified that Edward Spangler seemed to have great admiration for John Wilkes Booth and would do errands, odd jobs, and the like for him. Spangler and another man had modified the stable at the back of the theater at Booth's request, and when the actor wanted to sell his buggy, it was Spangler who sold it for him, doing so a few days before the assassination. Though his was a supporting role, Spangler still played an important part in the deadly plot when he arranged for Booth's horse to be held for his quick escape and when he tried to throw pursuers off his trail. Weighing the evidence, the court found him guilty, which he undoubtedly was. What were his religious beliefs, though? Edward Spangler was born in York, Pennsylvania on August 10, 1825. He reportedly was baptized there in the First Trinity Reformed Church about 4 months later. In 1858, he married a woman named Mary Brashears, 10 years his senior, in Baltimore. After a long illness, she died in this city on July 24, 1864. Despite extensive research, the identity of the church that they were married in or the denomination of the clergymen who conducted her funeral there could not be found. After being convicted, Edward Spangler was sent to the prison of Fort Jefferson in Florida along with the other conspirators, and he was released with Mudd and Arnold in 1869. Spangler became close to Samuel Mudd during their imprisonment, and he spent his last years working for him and living at the doctor's home in Maryland. Spangler died in February 1875, and until 1983, his body was buried in an unmarked plot in the graveyard at St. Peter's Church. St. Peter's is a Catholic church located about 5 miles west of where Mudd's farm was. Samuel Mudd, who died in 1883, was buried in the cemetery of St. Mary's Catholic Church in the neighborhood of Bryantown. Records of St. Peter's Church showed that on February 7th, the day the church documented as the time of his death, Spangler was baptized. He evidently had a deathbed baptism, but did he also have a deathbed conversion? It is possible that he could have converted to Catholicism years before, and then with death approaching, felt he should fulfill this sacrament. Spangler's membership in the Church of Rome, therefore, seems to have not been made clear until just before his passing. No direct evidence has surfaced of his Catholicism earlier in life, but this doesn't mean it never will. Booth's true religion didn't become public until years after his death. Constance Head commented regarding Booth's Catholicism, "Thus the secret remained so well guarded that even the most rabidly anti-Catholic writers who tried to depict the assassination of Lincoln as a Jesuit or Papist plot were puzzled by the seemingly accurate information that John Wilkes Booth was an Episcopalian." While complimenting rabidly anti-Catholic writers for caring about accuracy, Ms. Head also showed that information seemingly possessed about the beliefs of such historical figures may actually be wrong. This may be the case with Edward Spangler, too. For years before Lincoln's assassination, Spangler's associates and friends were Catholics. Prior to the president's murder, he was an admirer of a main leader of the conspiracy to kill President Lincoln, John Wilkes Booth, a Catholic that he knew and did work for. He assisted Booth in his escape. After the assassination, he was sheltered by Lewis Carland, another Catholic. He was put on trial and found to be part of a conspiracy dominated by Catholics. After being released from incarceration, he lived the rest of his life in close friendship with yet another Catholic, Samuel Mudd. His membership in the Church of Rome was seemingly finally revealed on his deathbed. His very close association with Romanists at the time of the assassination, as well as the fact of his Catholicism disclosed at the end of his life, however, does provide some evidence that in 1865, Edward Spangler was among the conspirators who belonged to the Church of Rome. George Atzerodt. The next conspirator to be considered is George Atzerodt, nicknamed Port Tobacco. After standing trial along with the others, he was found guilty of participating in the conspiracy to murder top officials in the United States government and executed along with Mary Surratt, Payne, and Harold. Though a coachmaker by profession, he was frequently ferrying spies and contraband across the Potomac River near Port Tobacco, Maryland, during the Civil War, hence his nickname. The prosecution alleged that Atzerodt's role on the night of April 14th was to kill Vice President Andrew Johnson. He was often seen in the company of many of the conspirators in the months preceding the assassination, and 6 weeks before, he had helped deliver guns and other provisions to Surrattsville to be picked up by Booth and Harold as they fled. Lieutenant W.R. Keim testified that a week to 10 days before the assassination, he shared a multi-person room in Pennsylvania House with Atzerodt. Leaving the room one morning, Atzerodt left a large Bowie knife in his bed, which Keim picked up. Atzerodt asked for his knife and after receiving it back said, "I want this. If one fails, I want the other." Keim also stated that Atzerodt was always armed with a revolver. Colonel W.R. Nevins testified that on the 12th of April, George Atzerodt entered the prestigious Washington Hotel, Kirkwood House, and asked where the vice president was. Nevins showed him where Johnson's room was and also ushered him to the dining room where the vice president was having dinner. Atzerodt evidently did not try to approach Johnson. The register of the hotel showed that Atzerodt checked into a room on the morning of the 14th before 8 o'clock. The vice president reportedly said that before the assassination, he heard footsteps in the room above him for hours. John Lee, the Washington detective, testified that Atzerodt's room was situated so the accused would normally pass by Johnson's door to get to the lobby. John Fletcher, foreman of Naylor's livery stable, stated that on the day of the assassination, Atzerodt and David Harold came to his stable at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Atzerodt left the mare there until later that night. Returning at 10 o'clock, he took a drink with Fletcher, who said he seemed to be half tight. Atzerodt told him, "If this thing happens tonight, you will hear of a present, or get a present." According to an employee of Pennsylvania House, the defendant came to the hotel between midnight and 1 o'clock on the night of the assassination, went into the bar, and then left. Proprietor John Greenewalt stated that Atzerodt and another man came back into the hotel between 2 and 3 in the morning and asked for a room. Greenewalt testified, "I had an uneasiness about the thing myself, thought there was something wrong." He also said Atzerodt hesitated when asked to register, something he had never done before. Early that morning, Atzerodt and the other man left the room. That morning, Atzerodt threw his Bowie knife away on a Washington street. Later that night, Detective John Lee entered the room Atzerodt had rented at Kirkwood House. There he found a loaded revolver, a large Bowie knife, a bank book of J. Wilkes Booth showing a credit of $455 at a Montreal bank, as well as a map of Virginia. Atzerodt was arrested by Sergeant L.W. Gemmell on April 20th near Germantown, Maryland. Gemmell testified that at the time, he did not ask why he was being arrested, and said he had not been in Washington recently. Among other charges, Atzerodt was accused of lying in wait to murder Andrew Johnson and conspiring to murder Abraham Lincoln. His defense was similar to John Surratt's. While in custody, he admitted that he was part of the conspiracy to kidnap the president, but he had only learned of the plot to murder Lincoln at 8 o'clock on the night of the assassination. He said he was assigned by Booth to kill Johnson, but he had refused to do it. According to him, Booth told me I was a fool, that I would be hung anyhow, and that it was death to every man that backed out, and so we parted. His defense was that he was guilty of conspiring to kidnap the United States Commander-in-Chief, therefore, but not conspiring to kill anyone. If true, this admission is of little comfort, as the kidnapping would have been a capital offense, and Lincoln could still have been killed if there were problems during its commission. As outlined earlier, there is strong evidence that a plan to kill existed long before the murder and was not created at the last moment. If the plan was only to kidnap Lincoln and not kill him and others, why did Atzerodt say to Lieutenant Keim in the Pennsylvania House, "If one fails, I want the other," regarding his knife and apparently his revolver? If Atzerodt was part of the conspiracy to kidnap the president and not kill the vice president, why did he find out what room Johnson was in? Why would he move into the unfamiliar surroundings of Kirkwood House on the morning of April 14th, where the vice president was staying, instead of the cheaper Pennsylvania House where he usually stayed? Atzerodt stated that the plan to kidnap was not changed until 8 o'clock that night. His lawyer alleged that he rejected Booth's plan and abandoned everything to do with the conspiracy, but was too afraid of Booth to tell the authorities. Four defense witnesses testified to Atzerodt's cowardice. In the end, however, he either wanted to murder Johnson, but was too afraid to act, or wanted no part of the murder. If he wanted to murder the vice president, but was afraid to act, he is still in agreement with the conspiracy. If he wanted no part of the murder plot, he could have warned the authorities, despite his supposed lack of courage, and saved Lincoln's life. This would have been his opportunity to show by his actions at the time, not by his words later, that he really did not want to be party to the assassination. Why did he say to John Fletcher shortly after 10 o'clock on that fateful evening, "If this thing happens tonight, you will hear of a present"? He was, by his own admission, talking about murder. The evidence shows that he was clearly guilty of plotting to kidnap Lincoln to help the Confederacy and assist in the breakup of the United States. His actions show he was also guilty of conspiring to, and at least desiring to, murder Vice President Johnson, even if he lost his nerve at the last moment and did not carry out the act. He was therefore rightfully convicted and executed for his treasonous acts. Lewis Payne, David Harold.
There was essentially no effort needed to prove the guilt of Lewis Payne and David Harold. Their lawyers were instead reduced to trying to explain their actions. Payne's defense called several doctors to testify in an attempt to show that he was insane, and most of Harold's witnesses stated that he was really no more than an easily influenced boy than a man of 22 years of age. Were Atzerodt, Payne, and Harold Roman Catholics? George Alfred Townsend asserted that all the conspirators were by education Catholics. Charles Tinneke alleged that all of the conspirators belonged to the Church of Rome, including these three, but they pretended to be of a different religion in order to hide the role the Catholic Church played in the terrible drama. He stated, "It is a well-authenticated fact that Booth and Weichmann, who were themselves Protestant perverts to Romanism, had proselytized a good number of semi-Protestants and infidels who, either from conviction or from hope of the fortunes promised to the successful murderers, were themselves very zealous for the Church of Rome. Payne, Atzerodt, and Harold were among those proselytes. But when those murderers were to appear before the country and receive the just punishment of their crime, the Jesuits were too shrewd to ignore that if they were all coming to the scaffold as Roman Catholics and accompanied by their father confessors, it would at once open the eyes of the American people and clearly show that this was a Roman Catholic plot. They persuaded three of their proselytes to avail themselves of the theological principles of the Church of Rome, that a man is allowed to conceal his religion, nay, that he may say that he is a heretic, a Protestant, though he is a Roman Catholic, when it is for his own interest or the best interests of his church to conceal the truth and deceive the people. Here is the doctrine of Rome on that subject. It is often more to the glory of God and the good of our neighbors to conceal our religious faith, as when we live among the heretics, we can more easily do them good in that way, or if by declaring our religion we cause some disturbances or deaths, or even the wrath of the tyrant. It is evident that the Jesuits had never had better reasons to suspect that the declaration of their religion would damage them and excite the wrath of their tyrant, the American people. Louis Paine, whose name actually was Louis Powell, was accompanied to the gallows by two Protestant clergymen, Reverend Gillette of the First Baptist Church of Washington and a Reverend Stryker. Dr. A.P. Stryker was an Episcopalian clergyman from Baltimore. Paine, the son of a Baptist minister, had pretended to be a Baptist preacher by the name of Wood. His name was not Wood, though. He clearly was not a Baptist clergyman either, and no historian has argued he was. It has been stated, though, in a number of historical accounts that at the time of the assassination, he was a Baptist, but court testimony indicates that he was not a member of this church at this time either. Dr. James Hall, a physician who examined Paine, was called by both the prosecution and the defense to testify before the military commission. He stated that Paine had acknowledged to me that at one time he had been a member of the Baptist church. Dr. Hall also stated that after examining Paine, he had found no evidence of insanity. Paine was accompanied to his execution by a Baptist clergyman and an Episcopalian minister, therefore, even though he was not a Baptist or an Episcopalian. This supports Charles Chiniquet's statement that the conspirators were not of the same faith of the clergyman that went with them to their execution. If he was not a Baptist, what was he? Could Paine really have been a Catholic instead of the Baptist he was mistakenly believed to be? What about the other two? Atzerodt was accompanied to his execution by a Lutheran minister, Reverend Butler, and by a Congregationalist clergyman, Reverend W.W. Winchester. There was no evidence given showing the supposed Lutheran attending a church service of the denomination that he allegedly belonged to. Court testimony did show, however, Atzerodt going to St. Aloysius Catholic Church in the nation's capital on Sunday morning, April 2, 1865. Harold went to the gallows in the company of an Episcopal clergyman, Reverend Olds, but as with Atzerodt, there was no evidence presented at the trial that showed him ever going to a church service of the denomination he supposedly belonged to. He had received education at Georgetown College, as had Arnold and Samuel Mudd. Court testimony also showed that this man, who received at least part of his education from this Romanist institution, attended a Catholic church service like his fellow conspirator, George Atzerodt. Although he had gone to Catholic church services, Booth was mistakenly believed to be an Episcopalian. His attendance at these Catholic services was puzzling if he did not belong to the Church of Rome, but his presence made perfect sense if he did. Being at these services was part of his life as a Catholic. Along with the evidence that virtually all of their close associates were Roman Catholics, doesn't the fact that Atzerodt and Harold attended these church services also show that they may very well have belonged to the Church of Rome? For years, it was accepted that Booth was a Protestant. Constance Head commented on the Catholic interest in seeing the well-guarded secret of Booth's religion remain buried. Of his membership in the Roman Church, she stated, "The few who knew of his conversion must have decided after the assassination that for the good of the church it was best never to mention it." Charles Chiniquet alleged that Harold, Atzerodt, and Paine were Roman Catholics. If so, could this same suppression of information that Head discussed regarding Booth be the reason that these three conspirators' Catholicism is not obvious today? Her statement also provided a concrete example of what Chiniquet wrote concerning the Church of Rome's counsel for her children to conceal their religion if it is not in the church's interest to have it known. As well, these conspirators were not plotting alone. The fact that Lincoln and Seward's murders were talked about in the solidly Catholic community of St. Joseph, Minnesota, before the deeds were carried out, points to the involvement of Catholic Church officials in the assassination plot. What connection would Booth, the Surratts, and other conspirators have had to Minnesota? How did this information get out to this location before the assassination unless, as Charles Chiniquet asserted, the priests of St. Joseph heard it from their fellow priests in the nation's capital? Charles Chiniquet stated that the staunch support of the Roman Catholic Church for the Southern cause, culminating in the open recognition of the Confederacy by the Pope, clearly encouraged Catholic priests to join the struggle for the South, which would have included helping in the destruction of its greatest enemies. As 50 years asserted, the presence of so many such priests in Mary Surratt's boarding house, the nest that hatched the egg, points to the involvement of the church in the plot. Chiniquet commented, "Booth was nothing but the tool of the Jesuits. It was Rome who directed his arm after corrupting his heart and damning his soul." He added, "The Jesuits alone could select the assassins, train them, and show them a crown of glory in heaven if they would kill the author of the bloodshed, the famous renegade and apostate, the enemy of the Pope and of the Church, Lincoln." Who does not see the lessons given by the Jesuits to Booth in their daily intercourse in Mary Surratt's house when he read those lines written by Booth a few hours before his death? "I can never repent. God made me the instrument of his punishment." Compare these words with the doctrines and principles taught by the councils, the decrees of the Pope, and the laws of the Holy Inquisition, as you find them in chapter 55 of this volume, and you will find that the sentiments and beliefs of Booth flowed from those principles as the river flows from its source. After a review of these facts, it can be concluded that there is very strong evidence that most, if not all, of the conspirators in the plot to destroy the head of America, the great Abraham Lincoln, as well as the nation and the ideals it stood for, were Catholics, aided and abetted by officials of the Church of Rome. Chapter 10. The Roman Catholic Church. The Church of God? A look at the history of the Roman Catholic Church, its evolution as a religious organization, the origin and development of its doctrines, as well as the deeds of its officials and lay members, can give valuable insight into whether it could be behind so great a crime as the murder of the head of the American nation, and whether it is, or is not, as Charles Chiniquet concluded, the true Church of God. Through the time of its existence, the Catholic Church has amassed tremendous power and influence, at times achieving almost complete world domination. Its glittering triumphs, however, have been rivaled by its defeats and scandals. Yet it has endured, claiming more than a billion adherents today, its wealth, power, prestige, and size continuing to grow. The Church of Rome's assertion that it is the only true church rests on its claim of unbroken apostolic succession, beginning with St. Peter, and also on its primacy or supremacy over the other churches of the world. On the foundation of an alleged unbroken line of popes leading a supreme church, it has attempted to build the claim that it is the only true religion, with salvation only available within its embrace. The problem with the Catholic Church's assertion of apostolic succession and primacy is that there appears to be essentially no evidence for it. According to God's Word, Simon Peter was not considered the Pope or head of the Church. Jesus congratulated Peter for correctly identifying him when he asked his disciples, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." What praise, position, and power seemed to be conferred on Peter! Jesus, however, then told his disciples that he would later go to Jerusalem to suffer, be killed, and then raised from the dead again. According to the scriptures, "Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, Get thee behind me, Satan, thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men." Was Jesus saying that his church would be built on Peter, a mere man whom he called Satan, when he said, "Upon this rock I will build my church"?
In the original Greek text that the English is translated from, the word Peter comes from the Greek word petros, meaning a piece of rock, a stone. And the word rock that Jesus said that he would build his church on comes from the word petra, meaning a mass of rock. A well-known Bible passage tells the parable of the wise man that built his house upon the rock. Here the word rock, which represents Christ, is translated from the word petra, not the word petros. No wise home builder would construct their home on a piece of rock or a stone that could shift. They would want to build on solid bedrock. In the expression, rock of offense, found in Romans 9:33, as it is written, "Behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed." The word rock, clearly a reference to Jesus Christ, also comes from the word petra. Despite Roman Catholic assertions to the contrary, this mass of rock, this bedrock that the true church is built on, is Jesus Christ, not Peter, a mere fallible man and the only one that the Bible records being called Satan by Jesus Christ. Chapter 16 of Matthew's Gospel records Jesus appearing to give the keys of the kingdom of heaven to Peter alone. The Roman Catholic Church teaches that it was just to Peter that these keys were given. As the Bishop of Rome, and in effect the head of the church on earth, he would decide who would enter heaven and who would not. The Catholic Church maintains that every person who desires to be accepted by God and be able to enter the church has to submit to Peter's teaching and authority as the visible substitute or vicar of Jesus Christ on earth. According to the Church of Rome, these keys and the power to decide who enters heaven were passed on to all bishops of Rome or popes that came after Simon Peter. A couple of chapters later in Matthew, however, it is clarified that these keys were given to all the disciples of Christ. Jesus said to his disciples, "Verily I say unto you, whatsoever ye," plural, "shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." God's word teaches that all the disciples were sent out to preach the gospel or good news. They were commanded to teach that all had sinned and violated God's law and therefore were facing his wrath. They were also to teach the good news that salvation from eternal punishment in hell and the lake of fire could be obtained by repentance from sin, simple faith in Christ, and acceptance of the atoning sacrifice of his shed blood on the cross. This message was the keys to the kingdom of heaven that Christ spoke of. Those that chose to continue to be enslaved by their own sin on earth by refusing to accept Christ's gift of eternal life would be bound in heaven and sent to eternal punishment. Those that chose to be freed on earth by accepting Christ would be free in heaven. This, the Great Commission to preach the gospel, is given to all believers in Christ. The scriptures do show that Simon Peter distinguished himself from the other disciples and apostles at other times, but not often in ways that others would want to copy. Peter was the only disciple at the Mount of Transfiguration that suggested making a tabernacle for Moses and Elijah, as well as Jesus Christ. Moses and Elijah appeared and spoke with Christ as he prayed apart up on a mountain with Peter and two other disciples. These two Old Testament prophets were great men of God, but they were still mere men who did not deserve a place of worship for their honor or veneration. Devotion and prayers to the dead saints is part of the teachings of this church that calls Peter its first pope, though. When a band of men came to capture Jesus, it was Peter who drew his sword and cut off the ear of one of them. Jesus rebuked him for doing so, declaring that they that take the sword shall perish with the sword. Simon Peter didn't understand that Christ had come to the earth to die on the cross, not to establish an earthly kingdom. Like Peter, the Catholic Church has apparently not understood this either, and has, for example, engaged in such things as the bloody crusades to take the Holy Land back by the sword. As well, the Holy See, situated at the Vatican, is a sovereign state, in direct contradiction of the words of Christ. He said in John 18:36, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight." This is not the only area that the doctrines of the Church of Rome are completely opposed to what the Bible teaches, however. In 2006, the Roman Catholic Church restated its support for evolution after a U.S. court decision, even though the Word of God clearly declares that mankind and all living species were created by God.
The book of Genesis and other scriptures teach that the world was created from nothing thousands of years ago, not millions or billions of years in the past. Peter was also referred to by name in God's word as boasting he would die with Christ and not deny him. The scriptures also record that Peter alone with curses denied his Lord three times. After he repented of his denial of Christ and was converted, Peter was truly used by God. He preached a sermon at Pentecost where 3,000 people were saved. God also used Peter to heal people and used him to raise a woman called Tabitha from the dead, causing many to become believers in Christ. God also gave him the vision of a sheet coming down from heaven, and it was Peter that preached to Cornelius, the centurion, and those with him, as the blessing of the Holy Spirit was poured out on this Gentile audience. The 15th chapter of Acts reported that Peter also played a significant role in the controversy regarding believers' circumcision that the early church had to deal with. God's word records that the apostles and elders met together in Jerusalem to consider this controversy. But the scripture does not show that Peter was the pope or head of the church, however. Though prominent, his voice was one of many this group heard, and it was James who gave judgment on what should be done, which the council agreed with. As well, the book of Galatians disclosed that the apostle Paul had to confront Peter and publicly rebuke him for his hypocrisy regarding his association with the Gentiles. So much for Peter's infallibility and headship of the church. As for prominence, God inspired Peter to write 2 books of the Bible, but used Paul to write 13. Much of another book, Acts, is about Paul's conversion and the journeys he made preaching the gospel. Paul also said in 2 Corinthians 12:11, "For in nothing am I behind the very chiefest apostle," clearly stating that he was in no way inferior to any apostle, including Peter. If Simon Peter was the first pope, he would have been a married one, since God's word stated that he had a wife. Instead of speaking of apostles and other leaders being celibate, throughout the Bible, marriage is spoken of approvingly. Hebrews 13:4 states, "Marriage is honorable in all and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers God will judge." The current Catholic Church scandals show that many Roman Catholic priests know something about adultery, as Charles Chinique alleged more than a century ago, and others before him. A large 2003 poll of the priests in England and Wales reportedly showed that a stunning 60% of them believed that adultery with a married woman should not bar them from the normal ministry of the priesthood. Was Peter the Bishop of Rome, as the Catholic Church says every pope has to be? The Bible records Peter following Jesus on his earthly ministry and later journeying only to Lydia, Joppa, Caesarea, and Antioch. In his letter to the church in Rome, Paul greeted some 25 people by name at the end of this epistle, but didn't mention Peter, the supposed head of the church. Why would this be if Peter was the bishop? The scriptures do not say Peter went to Rome. In fact, there appears to be little evidence, if any, that he was ever there. As well, there does not seem to be any proof that the Church of Rome had the primacy among the other churches in apostolic times. There was a church in Jerusalem before one was established in Rome, as it was in Jerusalem that Christ was tried, crucified, rose from the dead, and ascended to heaven. The Holy Spirit was poured out on the church on the day of Pentecost in Jerusalem, not Rome. The Great Commission was given to the apostles in Jerusalem, not Rome. Jesus said, "Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer, and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, not Rome." The scriptures show the early church council that discussed and debated circumcision for new believers did not call for a supreme Roman church to give its sentence on what the proper teaching should be on the subject. The recorded history of the early church also shows that there was no supreme church overseeing bishop or pope in Rome. Ignatius, bishop of Antioch, provided proof in his writings, dated near the end of the 1st century AD. He did not write of Peter alone, but of Peter and Paul together when referring to those with authority over the Roman church. When he wrote to other churches, he asked that they obey their own bishop. After being informed that he was to be executed, Ignatius wrote to the Roman church, asking them to pray for the Church of Syria, since it would not have him as bishop, but the Lord only for its shepherd. This clearly shows that during the early church age, the Bishop of Rome was not the ruler of the Catholic or Universal Church. Further proof of this comes from the case of Paul of Samosata, Bishop of Antioch, during the 3rd century AD. According to Eusebius, who was Bishop of Caesarea, Paul, the Bishop of Antioch, was tried by a church council for heresy, the charge being the denial of the divinity of Christ. At the conclusion of the trial, Paul was found guilty. The council, made up of bishops, deacons, and presbyters, did not come from Rome, but from Jerusalem, Tarsus, Caesarea, Pontus, and Iconium. The bishop pledged to retract his error, but did not honor his promise. In 270 AD, a second council, again made up of officials from those Asian churches, took Paul's bishopric from him and elected a new bishop. This was all done without the Roman Church playing any part in the proceedings. Among numerous other proofs of the Bishop of Rome's lack of supremacy is the statement by Cyprian, an important church father of the 3rd century. He wrote concerning a supreme bishop, "For none of us ought to make himself a bishop of bishops, or pretend to awe his brethren by a tyrannical fear, because every bishop is at liberty to do as he pleases, and can no more be judged by another than he can judge others himself." In his well-researched book, The Papacy and the Civil Power, former U.S. Secretary of the Navy Richard W. Thompson gave a historical outline of the early church's development. Before the time of Constantine, each of the several churches planted by the apostles and the early fathers exercised its own jurisdiction over its own members and thus preserved harmony in faith and worship. The right of visitorial guardianship, exercised by the apostles while planting and watering them in infancy, existed no longer because there was no longer any necessity for it. But while each church governed its own affairs, they all realized the necessity of preserving a spirit of unity and such brotherhood and fellowship among the whole as would enable them to sympathize with and assist each other in the adjustments of their local disagreements, if any should arise. A harmonious and beautiful Christian system was thus created, worthy of the divine approval, and under it the Catholic Apostolic Church was able to stand up and ward off the staggering blows of the pagan emperors. The first efforts to disturb this harmony were made by the bishops of Rome. About the beginning of the 3rd century, Victor I, with a view to establish the primacy of the Church of Rome, endeavored to compel the Asiatic churches, by threats of excommunication, to conform to its custom in keeping the festival of Easter. About half a century afterward, Stephen I attempted to assume jurisdiction over the Church of Spain, and, still later, Dionysius made a like attempt over the Church of Alexandria. These attempts at ecclesiastical absolutism at Rome were so sternly rebuked by the great fathers, Irenaeus and Cyprian, as to demonstrate that the leading churches could not be subjugated unless by some power they were unable to resist. The bishops of Rome soon saw that this power was political imperialism, and they availed themselves of the first opportunity of uniting church and state at Rome in order to obtain possession of it. This opportunity was the arrival of Constantine, at a time when the corrupt materials necessary for such a union were abundant at Rome. It is worthy to be repeated that, before the time of Constantine, each of the churches of Asia, Africa, and Europe had enjoyed its own independence, with no asserted or recognized principality in either over the others. Rome had no more power than Alexandria, or Alexandria than Antioch, or Antioch than Jerusalem. As the most ancient and first established churches, those of Jerusalem and Antioch had a sort of precedence of honor derived from the association of the names of the apostles James, the Lord's brother, and Peter and Paul with their history. But in neither of them had there been any pretense of authority or primacy set up. They were content to adhere in what they did and taught to the practice of that forbearance, charity, and toleration exhibited in the apostolic assembly at Jerusalem, by which they hope to lead the world into that condition of meekness and humility, which is experienced at the genuine impress of true Christianity upon the heart, whether it be that of prince or peasant.
Although gaining in privilege and wealth at the time of Constantine, the Church of Rome was still subject to him and his successors. Lacking in power, but not ambition, the clergy of Rome labored continually to increase the former while not diminishing the latter. An opportunity to achieve their objective came in the form of Pepin, the son of Charles Martel. Although in a high position in France, he wanted the French throne occupied by Childeric III. The monarch, though weak, was the rightful king of France. The monarch was the last of a line of rulers that descended from Clovis I over a period of some 250 years in accordance with French law. Unwilling to attempt to directly overthrow Childeric, Pepin, who sympathized with the popes in their struggle to end their subjection to the Eastern emperors, sent a message to Pope Zachary, asking him to use his power to release the people of France from their allegiance to their rightful king and put him on the throne. It appears logical in light of subsequent events that Pope Zachary's plan was to assist Pepin to become king, in return for Pepin's help in ending the church's subjection to the emperor.